Weighing 28 tons, these steel monsters could crush their way through the wire.
Under normal circumstances, barbed wire is no problem to a tank. It simply drives into it and squashes it flat. And normally, in doing so, will leave a path adequate, at least, for the infantry to follow. They pick their way a bit, lift their feet up, but they can step across that without any trouble.
Their six-pounder cannon and Lewis guns were designed to destroy German machine gun nests, which had previously decimated British attackers.
The gun is a 57mm. We would call it six-pounder in the British Army. They tended to use Nelsonian terms when talking about guns. It was really intended, in the first place, for taking out what we would call hard targets. That would be pillboxes, enemy vehicles, and that kind of thing. The problem was there weren't any, not really on the Cambrai front. You could fire high explosive at machine gun positions and strong points, that sort. But since the real target was human beings, the tanks with the machine guns were actually far more valuable.
New artillery tactics in the tanks made surprise possible, and these three together made victory possible. Many people contributed to the development of the tank. The single most influential person, however, was Winston Churchill.
What you're looking at here is the very first tank. It's known as Little Willy, which apparently was an unkind name for the Kaiser. And what makes it outstanding historically is that it was designed under the auspices of the British Admiralty. The Army had nothing to do with this. Winston Churchill, First Lord of the Admiralty at the time, impatient with the way the war is going in France and convinced there's better ways of doing it, gets his people, the Director of Naval Construction and a team of inventors, to come up with a solution. And at the end of their period of doing this, this is as far as they have got.
The prototype tanks and the original weapons were, of course, naval weapons. They were pioneered by Churchill in the naval department, and they were supposed to be land ships. But very quickly, the potential of these vehicles was recognised by anyone who had a head on their shoulders, and the army very quickly took control of them.
After conversations with many people concerned to break the trench deadlock, the much improved prototype became the model for the first production batch of tanks, the Mark I.
The actual configuration of the tank is designed to get the maximum possible cross-country performance, irrespective of absolutely anything else. So the tracks pass clear around the body. In fact, the body's sandwiched between them, rather than resting on top as it would be on a modern tank. All of this for a top speed of about 3 miles an hour on a good day. So it's all very crude, but very, very rugged.
Small numbers of tanks entered the Battle of the Somme in September 1916. And more tried to surmount the mud of Passchendaele a year later. In neither battle did they have much success. But by autumn 1917, enthusiasts in the tank corps were certain they knew why. Tanks had to be used in large numbers, on firm, hard ground, and if possible, by surprise. By late 1917, the tank enthusiasts were becoming more vocal. Tanks had been around in numbers for over a year, but they had made no name for themselves. Their machine guns now had armor-piercing ammunition, and though tanks could take a surprising number of bullet hits, they could not survive indefinitely.
This armor will keep out small arms fire on a good day. As you can see by the damage here, anything larger, from a small caliber anti-tank type gun up to a field gun, will simply smash its way through. There is example or spots here showing where machine gun fire has spattered and certainly dented the plate but not gone through. Here it is smashed through, and some of these, in fact, can be followed through to the other side so that you can actually look in one side of the tank and out the other.
The Germans had got over the shock of the previous day and had evolved methods of dealing with tank attacks.
The German theory was that you just fired at the damn things. You fired everything you'd got at them. You throw bricks at them, if you like. because something might stop them. And so you just loaded whatever was available into the gun and fired it.
Taking advantage of the poor visibility from within the tank, bolder troops also stalked them, throwing a sack of half a dozen grenades at a track to blow it off. In addition, the tank's return fire was only accurate if it came to a complete stop.
When the tank is moving, the amount of vibration coming up from the track is such that you can't actually see anything at all through the sighting telescope, and there's a slot here for the sighting telescope. It'd be an absolute waste of time. You'd fire to make a noise and frighten people.
At Cambrai, more tanks broke down than were knocked out. This was not surprising. At 28 tons, the tank was really too heavy for its engine, transmission, and suspension.
Unlike any modern vehicle where the engine has been completely separated from the crew, here, the eight men in the tank are working around the engine. They're working in conditions that are almost primeval. Terrifically high temperatures given off by the engine because the exhaust pipes run straight up from the top of the engine out through the roof. The noise levels are staggering. So loud, in fact, that you can't hear someone shouting in your ear. And the gaps between the metal plates are so badly put together that concentrated machine gun fire would literally splatter in tiny droplets of white hot lead through any gap that you could find. The effect inside is suddenly in the darkness of the interior to see what appear to be hundreds of little sparklers flying about all over the place. Very pretty, until of course they start stinging your face. And then finally, there's the carbon monoxide. The engine manifold will leak carbon monoxide as soon as it heats up, and very soon exhaust fumes are literally rolling through the tank.
After as little as 4 to 5 hours combat, the crew of eight could be totally exhausted and violently sick. A rule of thumb was that a day's combat would reduce available tanks by at least a half each day, quite apart from enemy action. So after 3 days, virtually no tanks or crews would be combat worthy, though in a few days the number would rise again. And the battle. Cambrai is remembered today as the first tank battle in history. It was not the first tank versus tank battle, because in 1917 the German army had no tanks, believing them to be a waste of time. Cambrai proved them wrong.
One of the other final results of the Battle of Cambrai, that the Germans have in their hands a great number of the British abandoned tanks, and for the first time they are able to start to collect them. 50 of the 100 tanks in German hands will be put on train and then drove to Charleroi, and with the 50 tanks they are going to make a small sortie in running condition.
Cambrai showed that properly used, tanks could crush barbed wire, cross trenches, destroy machine gun nests and knock out pillboxes. Tanks could dramatically reduce infantry casualties and give assault troops greater confidence. The Battle of Cambrai, however, also demonstrated the tanks' limitations and weaknesses. They could not operate in woods, for instance, and in the close environment of a town, they required infantry support. They needed protection from artillery and from stalking parties of infantry. They were too slow, too unreliable mechanically, and too exhausting for their crews.
The tank, by that stage in the war, really wasn't a breakthrough and pursuit weapon. It was only with faster, lighter tanks, such as the tanks that the French were developing, that would allow breakthrough and pursuit and really bring a war to an end by mobile means.